Hey, what's up, everybody? This is Dante Fortson here with another episode of Go Ask a Christian. This is episode 6. We're just going to talk about the Cushites a little bit, and we're going to see if we can find some answers as to why the role or the importance of the Cushites is downplayed. What does the word mean? All kind of questions may come up today. So if you want to support, you can go to patreon.com/Dante Fortson. Patrons get all kind of stuff first before the general public. And there's a lot more videos coming to the patrons, especially because of the new channel. So check that out as well if you haven't already. If you want to support anytime during the week, you can do so with Cash App with hashtag BHITB. The PayPal link is on the main channel page of YouTube. And of course, you're always welcome to drop something in the super chat during the premiere. For those asking about crypto, the crypto wallet addresses are in the description as well. All right, today's episode of Go Ask a Christian is brought to you by Bible Study on Demand. You get 10% off of orders over $10. Just use coupon code BSOD10. These are pre-made Bible study worksheets. They're denomination friendly. Buy them once, print as many copies as you want. BibleStudyOnDemand.com for all your Bible study needs. All right, go ahead and put those thumbs up, you guys. Hit that like button. If you haven't already subscribed, please do so. And please click the notification bell. Click all so you receive the notifications. It doesn't always work, but it does help. Lastly, share this video, please. Share this video with your Israelite friends. But more importantly, share this video with your Christian friends. All right. For those of you that don't know what the Go Ask a Christian series is about, it's a series where we point out stuff in the Bible and we challenge people to go ask Christians about it, because a lot of times their doctrine doesn't line up with what's written. And we're going to talk today about the Middle East. What is the Middle East? Why is there a Middle East, but there's not a Middle Northwest or South? What do the Cushites have to do with the Middle East? Why is it that when we talk about Middle East, we're presented with a historical depiction of light-skinned people that didn't come around until after the Greek, Roman, and Arab invasions? Why isn't it stressed exactly who the Cushites are in the Bible and why they're important? All right, so to kick this off, I went to nationalgeographic.org, and if you go Google National Geographic, Cush with a K, or even Cush with a C, you will find this article. It says, Nubian Kush, the legendary kingdom of Kush, with its capitals in what is now northern Sudan, helped define the cultural and political landscape of northeastern Africa for more than 1,000 years. Kush was a part of Nubia, which stretched from the Upper Nile to the Red Sea. Don't we see the Red Sea in the Bible? So we know we're talking about Africa. Now, it says Kush influenced the cultural and political landscape of northeast Africa for more than 1,000 years. So how is it we don't learn about Kush when we start studying the Bible in many Christian churches? I grew up in the Christian church. I didn't hear about Kush outside of the random mention, but definitely no Bible studies on Kush or its importance to the Bible or which areas that they inhabited, other than a quick mention that they're Africans. So a lot of this stuff I learned about Kush is when I got older. But how is it that Kush is not stressed or highlighted, especially when there are important biblical people who descend from Kush? All right, so the Cushites. So now we know Kush comes in this area, and the word Kush is going to be, or Cushite, is going to be translated into Ethiopian or Ethiopians throughout Scripture. And we know how important the Ethiopians are to Scripture. Then we're going to read in a second right here, the Cushites also traveled over here and established all of this. This is Cushite territory. All of this, again, Cushite territory, all of this in what is called the Middle East on the Arabian Peninsula. And yet when we talk about the Middle East, we're not presented a picture of Cushites establishing the Middle East. In fact, people act like we're crazy to say that we're Israelites, because supposedly we don't have any Middle Eastern DNA, but it's okay for other people to call themselves Cushites, even though the Cushites established the Middle East. So how is it that you can say we're not Israel because we don't have any Middle Eastern DNA, but yet y'all will agree that we are Cushites, even though the Cushites help establish the Middle East? It just doesn't make sense. Let that sink in for a while. The Cushites help establish the Middle East, and they say we can't possibly be Israel because we have no Middle Eastern connections, but we can be Cushites, even though Cushites have Middle Eastern connections. It doesn't make sense. Somebody is lying, and we're going to figure it out. It says, and the sons of Ham. Remember, they say Ham is the father of all black people. This is the narrative they want you to run with. The sons of Ham, Cush and Mizraim and Foot and Canaan. Wait a minute. Canaan is the land of Israel, correct? So wait a minute. Hamites were in the land of Israel, and they told you Hamites are where black people come from. And yet black people can't be Israel because we have no Middle Eastern connections. And yet we can be Hamites, even though, as I said, established the Middle East. The story doesn't add up. We can't both establish the Middle East and have zero Middle Eastern connections, which is how they determine that we can't possibly be Israel. Now, I'm not saying that we're Hamites. Just to be clear, I'm not saying that we're Hamites. I'm saying that they call us Hamites and say we don't have any Middle Eastern connection, and yet we read the Bible and they have Middle Eastern connections. We say we're Israel, and they say, no, you guys don't have Middle Eastern connections, but you can be one of these other people connected to the Middle East. It doesn't make sense. Their logic is off somewhere. And the sons of Cush, Seba, and Havilah, and Sabta, and Rama, and Sabteca, and the sons of Rama, Sheba, and Dedan. And Cush begat Nimrod. So Nimrod in the Bible is a Cushite. He looked like the Christian Cushite over there. They're always yelling out he a Cushite. Nimrod was a Cushite. And he began to be a mighty one in the earth. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Wherefore it is said, even as Nimrod, the mighty hunter before the Lord. And the beginning of his kingdom was Babel and Erech and Akkad and Calneh in the land of Shinar. Look here at the map. This is Shinar. So you have Cushites establishing the Middle East in the land of Shinar. Why is it distress? We hear about Nimrod, but they don't stress his Cushite connection, because Cush is the son of Ham, and Ham is the son of Noah, which makes Nimrod a black grandson of Noah. How is Noah having black grandsons if Noah ain't black? Show me an example of non-black people having Hamite children. See, these are the Hamites. This is the important part. Noah's grandson is a Hamite, a black Hamite. Show me an example of non-black people having Hamite sons. Not just dark-skinned Europeans or dark-skinned something else. Show me that they have Hamite children. You know, the ones they say look like us. Show me an example of a European having Negro or children with Negroid features or look similar to Negroes. It's not going to happen. So now, I asked the question, where is Shinar? And we just saw it on that map, but where is Shinar? So if you Google this, where is Shinar today? Right here you get, where is Shinar, Tower of Babel, Babylonia. So it tells us in Babylonia, it says, overview of the Tower of Babel. The Tower of Babel in biblical literature, structure built in the land of Shinar, Babylonia, sometime after the deluge or Noah's flood. The story of its construction given in Genesis 11, 1-9, appears to be an attempt to explain the existence of diverse human languages. So this Cushite empire that occurs in the Bible was built sometime after the flood, and it's located in Babylonia. So where is Babylon or Babylonia? Right here. Where would Babylon be located today? Iraq. The city of Babylon, whose ruins are located in present day Iraq. Ain't nobody gonna tell you Iraq ain't in the Middle East. So we got Cushites in the Middle East. It was founded more than 4,000 years ago as a small port town on the Euphrates River. It grew into one of the largest cities of the ancient world under the rule of Hammurabi. And some people say that Nimrod is Hammurabi, but we're not going to get into that right now. So we're looking at this, and we see that Cushites established the Middle East. The descendants of Ham established the Middle East. You have Canaan all in the land of Israel. You have Cush all in modern day Iraq. All up and around there, you have Hamites. And yet they're telling us we're crazy for saying that Israelites are the people over here that were enslaved through the transatlantic slave trade. Why do we say that? Because all throughout the Bible, Israelites get mistaken for Hamites. They get mistaken for Egyptians, descendants of Ham. They mix with descendants of Ham. I'm going to do a video on that, about the mixing going on in the Bible. And not once do we see Israel mixed with anybody from Japheth. We'll come back to that, though. So now, I want to be clear where Iraq is. For those that don't have a clear overhead view of where Iraq is, this is Iraq. this whole red area, this is Baghdad, the capital of Iraq. And then if you come right over here, this sliver, this whole sliver is Israel. You know, the land of Canaan, which were the Hamites. So you have this whole area known as Israel, all Hamite territory in the Bible. And then all this was Hamite territory in the Bible, maybe more. And then you come over here, you can see it on the map, Hamite territory, Hamite territory, Hamite territory. So the Hamites had stretched all the way over to here, and yet they're telling us that whenever we bring it up, no, they look Middle Eastern. They weren't black. They were brown. So you're telling me Hamites are both black but not black at the same time? This is the nonsense that they're teaching. You have some of these Christians over here tell you, again, you have no Middle Eastern connections, but yet you can be located to the people who helped establish the Middle East. It doesn't make sense. Why are they not emphasizing how influential the Kushites were, not only to the Bible, but to history in general and to the Middle East? They don't want any mention of it. They don't want any reference of it because they want to push the lie that the Middle East was always light, bright, and damn near white. This is after Greek, Roman, and Arab invasions. But before that, the Middle East were Kushites. They were Canaanites. They were Hamites. Descendants of Ham. You know, the ones they say that black people, all black people descend from. So now here's a picture of the islands. And the reason we have black people in these islands is due to the transatlantic slave trade and being carried over to the islands, which wouldn't have happened had it not been for slavery. They didn't migrate there. They were carried there. It says, and it shall come to pass. This is important. Old Testament stuff. Isaiah 11:11-12. It shall come to pass. Not it might. And if any Christian tells you, well, this already happened, ask them when. If they say it already happened, make them give you the exact date. Because history, once history happens, we know the dates. We know the times, we know the locations. So if they tell you it's already happened, make them show you. And if it has not happened, ask them, when does this happen? Who's it referring to? And it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall set his hand again the second time to recover the remnant of his people, which shall be left from Assyria and from Egypt, Africa, and from Pathros, Africa, and from Cush, Africa, and from Elam near the Cushite civilization in Shinar, and from Shinar, Cushite territory, and from Hamath, and from the islands of the sea. Why are Israelites scattered in the islands? And he shall set up an ensign or a sign for the nations, and shall assemble the outcast of Israel, and gather together the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth. Did Israel migrate, or did they get pushed into the four corners of the earth through slavery, such as Deuteronomy 28 says? Now, they'll tell us, well, Deuteronomy 28 doesn't apply to you. It applied for a different time. And yet, when we read Deuteronomy 28, the curse was upon them and their seed forever. Not a period of time, not temporarily, forever. And we get into the word forever. Go check out the other video. Go ask a Christian, thy seed forever, upon thy seed forever. So now we have Israelites being gathered out of multiple African territories, including Kushite territories. Why is it? Is it possible that Israelites could blend in with these African people in these areas that were founded by Hamites? And let me differentiate. There's a difference between African and Hamite. I do want to make that clear. So let me restate that. Is it possible that Israelites are blending in with Hamites? Because African refers to the continent itself. You can be European if you're from the continent of Europe. You can be Asian if you're from the continent of Asia. Same thing with American and Mexican and everything else. There's a difference between ethnicity and location, and it's important to differentiate. So when people talk crazy about Africans, they're doing so out of ignorance, because Africa is a location. It is a continent. Africa is not an ethnicity. It is not a people group. So you can be an Israelite who was born and raised in Africa. So you'd be an Israelite African. That would be your ethnicity and your location. So I just want to make that clear so people understand what I'm saying when I say, when I refer to Africans, when I refer to Israelites, when I refer to Kushites, there's a difference between ethnicity and location. So the Kushites. The Kushites are mentioned in more ways than one in the Bible. There's another root, or another word that comes from the root word for Kushite, which is Cush. It's cushy. And so when I saw this word, I'm like, that's an interesting name for a person. And so as I started to dig, I found out the word is an ethnonym, which basically it's a proper name that refers to one's ethnicity or people group. And so there are multiple ethnonyms in the Bible, because I went looking, and I'm going to do a separate Go Ask a Christian on ethnonyms in the Bible. But if you look up Cushy, what does Cushy mean? Wikipedia says the word Cushy or Cushy is generally used in the Hebrew Bible to refer to a dark-skinned person of African descent, equivalent to the Greek Ethiops or Ethiopian. So wait a minute, there are words in the Bible that refer specifically to people's skin color? Interesting. I thought the Bible doesn't mention skin color. Isn't that the lie we're fed? It's not about that. We're going to get back to some of this. But there's a word in the Bible that specifically refers to people's skin color. And again, these words are called ethnonyms. If we go down, Urban Dictionary, Hebrew slang that translates as ape or monkey and commonly used in place of the N-word to insult black or simply darker skinned people. So I'm sitting here looking at this stuff and I'm reading these and I'm like, that's interesting. These people aren't Israelites putting out this information. Israelites don't run Wikipedia, the Urban Dictionary. These are not, well, let me be clear here when we talk about ethnicity. These are not people that acknowledge their Israelite heritage that run these things. And yet they're putting out information saying that this word Cushy refers specifically to people's skin color and black people specifically and is used as a racial slur. Here's one, forward.com, is Cushim a racist Israeli term for blacks? So now, we have this ethnonym that specifically refers to people's skin color. So when we start to look, why do we find Israelites with the name Cushy? Why would an Israelite have a name that refers specifically to their skin color, but more specifically have a name that refers to a dark-skinned or black skin color? And he's not the only one, but it says, and behold, Cushy came, and Cushy said, tidings, my lord the king, for the Lord hath avenged thee this day of all them that rose up against thee. 2 Samuel 18:31. And then you have this. Therefore, all the princes set Jehudi, the son of Nethaniah, the son of Shelemiah, the son of Cushy, unto Barak, saying, let me start over. It says, therefore, all the princes sent Jehudi, the son of Nethaniah, the son of Shelemiah, the son of Cushy, unto Barak, saying, take in thine hand the roll wherein thou hast read in the ears of the people, and come. So Barak, the son of Neriah, took the roll in his hand and came unto them. Can an Ethiopian change his skin color? Just a question. And the word of the Lord came on the Lord, word of the Lord, which came unto Zephaniah, the son of Cushy. Wait a minute. Well, Zephaniah was a prophet, Israelite prophet. So why is he the son of an Israelite named Cushy? In reference to his black skin, how is it that you have Israelites descended from people referred to as having black skin if Israelites don't look like black people at all? They look Middle Eastern according to them. They look light skin. they look like post Greek, Roman, and Arab invasion Israelites. Their story doesn't add up. Let's keep going. So now I decided to Google Cushite, because you know you got the other channel over there. I'm a Cushite. So here's what we see. We get Cushites. This is what we see. And Miriam and Aaron spake against Moses because of the Ethiopian woman, for he had married, whom he had married, for he had married an Ethiopian woman. Numbers 12:1. This is a word translated as Cushite, Greek Ethiops, Ethiopian. You're going to see it throughout the Bible. The Cushites, why is Moses marrying a Cushite woman? Why is Moses marrying a black woman? And make no mistake, this is not Miriam. Miriam is a descendant of Midian, who is the son of Abraham and Keturah. The Cushites are descendants of Ham. Two different lineages, so we know they're not talking about the same woman. For anybody that wants to leave a message trying to tell me that this is Keturah and she's really from, or not Keturah, this is Zipporah and she's really from Midian. Again, misspoke, Zipporah. They try to say that, well, this isn't really an Ethiopian woman. She's from Midian. No, Moses had two wives. Common sense tells you, if they tell you one is a Midianite and then they tell you he married an Ethiopian woman, common sense should tell you Moses had two wives, at least, maybe more. But they're not mentioned to my knowledge. I know these two are Zipporah, the Midianite, descendant of Abraham and Keturah, and an Ethiopian woman, a.k.a. a Cushite descendant of Ham. Can the Ethiopian change his skin, or the leopard his spots? Then may ye also do good that are accustomed to do evil, Jeremiah 13:23. So why is there a reference to Ethiopians changing their skin color? If you guys go back and watch The Curse of White Skin on Go Ask a Christian, episode 5, we point out that changing someone's skin color is something that God does. And so if they can't change their skin, it explains why turning Moses' arm white was considered a sign that God's hand was in it. So the Ethiopian can't change their skin color. And again, the wolves are going to tell you, oh, the Bible doesn't mention skin color. And yet we're seeing example after example where the Bible not only mentions skin color, it has names for people to describe their skin color. God changes people's skin color. And he rose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, a Cushite, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, or queen of the Cushites, who had the charge of all her treasure, had come to Jerusalem for to worship. Why are Cushites coming to worship in Jerusalem? Why are they coming all the way from Ethiopia to worship in Jerusalem? Was returning and sitting in his chariot, read Isaiah the prophet. Why would he read Isaiah? Why would a Cushite come to Jerusalem to worship and have a copy of the book of Isaiah? Just ask yourself why. You don't have to ask the Christian that. If you don't know yourself, just think about that. If you are the Christian and you're watching this, ask yourself why a Cushite was coming to worship in Jerusalem and why he had a copy of the book of Isaiah. And again, I'm not saying that we are Cushites. I'm not saying that Israelites and Cushites are the same thing. I'm just pointing out that the importance of the Cushites in the Christian church is downplayed, completely downplayed, as far as their biblical presence and their historical importance goes. And these are not all the references. These are just the few I pulled out for the purposes of this video. So now I want you to go ask your Christian friends a few questions. And if you are the Christian friend watching this, I want you to try to answer these questions, because it comes down to truth. And the wolves don't want you to explore the truth. The wolves will tell you that a white lie is more acceptable than a black truth. The wolves will tell you it's okay to cast white Jesus. It's okay to cast white Israelites and white Egyptians in a movie, but it's not okay for you to talk about them being black, because then you're putting skin color over Christ. They change the narrative depending on our skin color and then try to demonize us and say we make it about skin color. It's not true. So why is the significance of Cushites in the Bible downplayed in modern Christianity? Ask yourself that. Why do they downplay black culture, but they got you out here celebrating Christmas? It's okay to celebrate Saint Nick and make him share a day with Jesus. They say it's all about Jesus. Jesus is the reason for the season. We'll kick Santa Claus off his day. Give Jesus his own day if Jesus is the reason for the season. But anyway, they downplay the significance of Cushites in the Bible. They downplay anything black in the Bible, whether it's Hamite or Israelite. If it's black, it's whack to them. Why doesn't modern Christianity teach that the descendants of Cush inhabited and founded the Middle East? Now, the Bible says this very plainly. I read the verses. And yet they don't want to say that, because whenever you start to bring up people, black people in the Middle East, oh, they weren't black. They were Middle Eastern. They were brown. Okay, but you told me Hamites were black, and the Canaanites and Cushites are Hamites, and they are clearly establishing major parts of the Middle East. The whole land of Israel and modern day Iraq or Shinar or Babel, that whole situation there. So how is it that they won't teach us that? Because they know it starts to fall apart. Their lie starts to fall apart if you start telling us Cushites established the Middle East and be like, oh, you guys are Cushites. You're not Israel. I know it appears that you may be like Israel, but you guys are actually Cushites, but you have no connection to the Middle East, but you guys help establish the Middle East, so you can be Cushites, but you can't be Israel. Oh my goodness, that's so funny to me. I have fun doing these, you guys. So why would God gather Israelites out of Cushite territory? That's what I want to know. Why is God gathering Israelites out of Cushite territory? He didn't say nothing about gathering them people out of Europe. I didn't see that. I read Isaiah 11:11. Maybe y'all can find it. Go read Isaiah 11:11 in its entirety. And feel free to send me the verse where God is gathering black people, Israelites specifically, out of European nations, which he will gather them out of European nations, but you have to wonder why they're not even named there. Show me in scripture. Why would God compare Israelites to the children of Cushites? Are ye not as the children of Ethiopians unto me? You guys go read that verse. Are ye not as children of the Ethiopians or children of the Cushites unto me? Are you not similar to the children of the Cushites to me? Was he talking about skin color or was he talking about something else? How was Israel similar to the Cushites or the Ethiopians? How? Answer that question if you're the Christian. If you're not the Christian, if you're on the fence, answer the question. If you're not on the fence, go ask your Christian friends. Why would God make that comparison? Why did God defend Moses' marriage to the Cushite woman? Miriam was a prophetess. Aaron was a prophet. And they approached Moses and God punished them for getting out of pocket and having something to say about Moses' marriage to the Ethiopian woman or the Cushite woman. Why is that? See, there's a lot of stuff that gets downplayed in this book. And we're going to come back. We're going to talk about some more ethnonyms. But for now, these questions are sufficient. Ask your Christian friends about the Cushite presence in the Bible. Ask them about the Cushites founding the Middle East. There's a reason they very likely will not be able to tell you. And that's because it does not go along with the narrative of modern Christianity that there wasn't no black people around in that area. They don't want us to even think we might be associated with Israel. And this is why they have to downplay Cush, because Israelites were mistaken for Hamites. And if you're honest, 100% honest, and make it clear that Hamites established the land of Israel. Hamites made league with David. The Hittites, they were Hamites. Bathsheba, it tells us what Hamite tribe she was from. I'm gonna do a study on that. I know some people say Bathsheba was an Israelite. No. It tells us exactly what lineage Bathsheba is from in the Bible, and it's a Hamite lineage. It names a Hamite lineage. Uriah, one of David's mighty men, is said to be a Hittite, a descendant of Ham. What is going on in the Bible? Why are Hamites all over the Middle East, and yet we're presented these people right here on the screen, and they're telling us these are the people of the book. These are the people that were in Egypt. These are the people that were marrying Egyptians and Cushites and Canaanites and every other descendant of Ham, and they came out looking like this. These are the people that spent 400 years of servitude, harsh servitude in the African sun with no sunscreen, no nothing, harsh bondage. These are the people. This is what we're supposed to believe. Something is not adding up, and these people need to answer for it. So let's talk about six common cop-outs, because when you start to ask these questions, when they don't want to answer, they'll use the cop-out. So I went ahead and Googled Jesus. I Googled Jesus. This is an interesting segue. And this is what comes up. I see this guy right here. They're telling me this is the guy that God sent to live in Africa and blend in among the descendants of Ham. How was that possible? How is this guy blending in among the descendants of Ham in Africa? Six common cop-outs. It's not about that. Well, yes, it is, because now we're seeing in the Bible that there are words called ethnonyms that describe people based on their ethnicity, their skin color. And it's not the only one. We're going to jump on some of the other ones. Kedar, Niger, Cushi. We're going to talk about these. There are more in there, too. So it is about that. My book, The Bible, says it's about that. It's not about skin color. Well, clearly it is, because they have words to describe people based on skin color. We have example of God turning people's skin color, specifically white, changing people's skin color as a sign. We have multiple references to skin color all throughout the Bible. That shouldn't be our focus. Well, it definitely should be our focus if the Bible is referring to people based on skin color. Yeah, now that's my focus. You're putting culture over Christ. Nope, I'm putting truth over fiction. Somebody said that in the comments. Shout out to that person. I don't have your name right now. Putting truth over fiction, truth over lies, fact over fiction. So yes, that's what we're doing. Not putting culture over Christ, because the book says it. And so we have every right to study every single thing in the book. Nobody can tell you not to study something in the book. Only a wolf would tell you that certain things in the book aren't important. You're being carnal and serving the flesh. Now, the Bible says study to show yourself approved. So if I see those words mentioned in the Bible, I'm going to study them to show myself approved, and I'm going to dig and question until I get answers. Why does it, aka lying, matter? Why does it matter if we give you white Jesus? It's not about that. Why does it matter if we give you white Israelites and white Egyptians? It's not about that. Don't say he's black, though, or you're putting culture over Christ, and you're not saved, and you're a moderate, and you're not of God, and you're in a cult if you say he's black. But if we spend millions of dollars to give you white Jesus, white Israel, white Egyptians, and we put it on that big screen, perfectly fine. We can be Christians. We can be believers. You can't say Jesus is black for free, but we can spend millions to feed you the lie of white Jesus. This is what the Christian church teaches right now by their actions. So you guys start asking these questions to them and don't let them get away with these cop-outs. If they're okay with spending millions to push white Jesus, they shouldn't have anything to say to black people for saying Jesus is black for free. So yes, go ask a Christian. They owe us some answers. And if you do get any of those answers, please share those answers with me. So I do have more of these coming for you guys. And with that said, till next time, I'm out.